Okay, so without just delaying more, we will be starting with the workshop. And let me introduce myself. I'm Harshit. I'm in from Computer Science Engineering stream from third year, and we will be covering the basic introduction to programming in C++, basically at first, and then in the segment of the workshop, we will be explaining, like discussing on what other languages are important for you to discover in later of your college life. So that part of will also be covered in the segment two. And in the first segment, you will be just getting to know and learn about the syntaxes and the basics of what exactly the programming is composed of and why it is necessary, and also the brief history about the C++ and how it is developed. So I will just invite my acquaintance with me, Mr. Kunal, if you can just proceed with the first segment of the workshop.
Good evening, guys. My name is Kunal Agarwal, and my branch is EC2, second year. Please give me a minute. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it
Good evening, guys. First of all, introduction to programming with C++. First of all, questions arises why coding is necessary. Coding is necessary because it solves the real world problems and in getting the solution for common issues. Such as our senior tells us that in robotics it helps very much. Its syntax, its basics of C++. It builds digital platforms and infrastructure also. It helps in data modeling on a large scale via coding implementations. Next is how C++ was developed. In 1979, a Danish computer scientist named Bjarne Stoustrup, he started began work on C with classes when he was doing PhD. He suddenly realized that his goal was to add object-oriented programming into the C language, due to which in 1982 the name of the language changed from C with classes to C++, and due to him now nowadays also we study about object-oriented programming in C++, and in 1984 he implemented the first tree. That is the input-output library. And you will glad to know that as and now in 2021, C++ is ranked fourth on the TOB index after C, Python, and Java. Next is the basic concepts of C++. The basic concepts of C++ are there are first is variables. Variables hote kya hain? A variable is a name given to a memory location. For example, we define a variable by name a and we assign it a value a equals to 4 or b equals to 6. Those are called variables and it's a basic unit of storage in a program. The value in the variable we can store before the execution of the program and during the execution of the program also. It's up to the user or it's up to the person who is performing the program. In C++, all the variables must be declared before use. That is, we should declare all the variables before executing the program, and we can enter the values even during the execution also. Next is data type. There are various data types in the C++. Data type is a set of values which are it's a set of values together with a set of operation. There are three different categories of data types. First is simple data types, next is structure, and another is pointers data type. First, we will talk about simple data type. Simple data types are the data types which are simply the, like, for example, a equals to 4. It is an integer data type. Floating data type are the, for example, a equals to 4.5 or b equals to 9.6. In integer data type, we cannot provide the decimal values to the variables. But in floating type, we can. And in enumeration type, in this, we have user-defined data type. In this, the data is defined by the user. Next is structured data type. In structured data type, it's a collection of data types of other data items. For example, array, structure, union, and class. Array, for example, we have defined an array of integer array. It will store the values of all the integer variables only. And in similarly in structure, we define similar variables.
Hello.
Next is pointer data type. In pointer data type, a pointer refers to a variable that holds the address of another variable. In this, the pointer holds the address of the another variable. For example, we have defined a pointer variable, say, हेलो किसी को कोई डाउट है नेक्स्ट इज पॉइंटर डेटा टाइप इन दिस द वेरिएबल्स आर डिफाइंड एज पॉइंटर इट होल्ड अ पॉइंटर होल्ड्स द एड्रेस ऑफ द नेक्स्ट वेरिएबल टू व्हिच इट इज लिंक्ड फॉर एग्जांपल वी हैव फॉर एग्जांपल अ पॉइंटर ऑफ टाइप इंटीजर इट कैन होल्ड द एड्रेस ऑफ वेरिएबल ऑफ टाइप इंटीजर ओनली If we define a variable pointer type variable, say for example integer a, it will hold the address of another variable whose integer only. It cannot hold the address of another variable which is float or it's an enumeration type. Next are the operators which are used in the C++ programming. Operators are used to perform operation on variables and values. Some operators are, first of all, it is plus, which we are normally also used. That is, it is used for addition. That is, if we want to add two variables, we use the operator plus. Minus, and it is used for subtraction. Division, it is used for division. And percentage, that is, it is also called modulus. It is used for division, but it gives remainder also. Division, in this division, for example, if two variables, say 4 divided by 2, it gives 4 divided by 3. If we divide 4 divided by 3, if we use this division part, slash part, it will not give the point, it will not give the answer in points. It will give only the integer value. For example, it will only give 1. But in modulus, it will give 1.5 or 1.2 as per the answer. Next is double plus and double minus. It is also called increment and decrement. It increases the value of the variable by 1. For example, if we write C++ or A++, it is meant that A equals to A plus 1. And next is the multiplication. It is used to multiply the two variables. For example, A into B or B into C, which we regularly use. Next are the functions which we define in C++. Basically, a function is a block of a code, which only runs when it is called. That is, if we define a function within the outside the main, it will be called when it will be used when it will be called. We can pass the data in the functions known by the method known as parameters. For example, this is syntax. It has syntax as void my function. Yeah, we have void status. In this brackets, after this void my function, we have brackets, open and closing brackets. In this, we provide the parameters or the variables in which we have to store the value, which will be given during the execution of the program or which is given in the main program. And in the curly brackets, we have the code to be executed. That is the code which is required to be executed. Next are the loops. these are the loops are the blocks of a code. As long loops are handy because they save time, they also reduce errors and they make code more readable. For example, here are two loops. First is while loop and another is for loop. In while loop, we have syntaxes while in bracket, in open and close brackets, we have condition that is to be followed, and in curly brackets we have the code which has to be executed. And in for loop we have for, and in open close brackets we have first is initialization, that is we first initialize the variables, then we check the condition for it, for example if they're equal or not, or they're smaller less than, and then we do updation. Updation means that it is changing the value of the variable. For example, a, if we initialize variable a equals to 1 and condition is by checking that a is smaller than 10, if its condition becomes true, it will execute the program and then return to the for statement and update the variable. That is, it will change the variable a equals to 2 and then execute the program once again. We will do some problems also. Give me a minute, please. It's a basic program. In this, we have first included the file, that is using function hash include. We have introduced IO stream, that is input output stream. It is a basic file which is used for C in, C out. In this, first is we have declared the main function by int main, that is we have, and then we have C out hello world. That is, it will show that we have, it will show the result of hello world. Like this. Next is the while loop. Example of a while loop. Similarly, we have defined a file iostream using then for main function, and then we have initialized the variable I equals to 1. Here, I is the variable, integer is the data type, and then next we have started with
what is namespace? I believe he got disconnected. If you want to like use the standard functions of like if you want to not write std colon colon c out, then you just write using namespace std, and it calls out the standard functions, and you'll directly be able to use cout instead of std.
So it's like a category for a set of functions.
Yes, you can definitely say that. It's like something standardized, and it has been there for a long time. So if you have been using Turbo C++, then you probably won't be needing that because it's an old compile, but in newer ones you define it in this way. In if you go ahead in competitive coding, you it's usually like you have to define this because they you can call anything out there. So yeah, Kunal, you can continue.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, in while loop, first we check the condition that I is smaller than or equals to 5 or not. If it is smaller than or equals to 5, it will execute the program till it becomes equals to 5. Like this, we have in, we have got the output as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In this, we have got because this plus plus I. In first, when I equals to 1, it prints the variable, it prints the value 1. And then it increments the value 1, that is I equals to I plus 1. And then it works until I becomes equals to 5. Okay. and it's a function of a for loop. In while loop, we define variable in the before the main before the loop, but in this we have defined the variable in the for loop only. In this we have defined the integer I equals to 1, then we have checked the check the condition if it is smaller than or equals to 5. If it is smaller than 5, it will see out, it will print the hello world on the output screen. When it becomes equals to 5, it will stop executing. It will come out the for loop and it will stop executing. For example, this. And then this program, we have got 5 hello worlds, 5 times hello world. You can all give it a try. Hello.
Are you done with your part, Kunal? Like, or is there anything you would like to perform?
Ek program.
You can just illustrate an example in front of the student so that they can just grab it. The syntax is, I think they're not clear with it.
Okay. Another example like this. In this, we have a main function in which we at first define the variable number with data type integer, and another is sum. In this, we have assigned the sum equals to 0. In this, we take the number from the user, and it will. Cout function does that, it will print the whole text onto the output screen, and it will then take the value of that variable. For example, in this, it will print that enter number. For example, in this as we executed, it asks for a number, and then when we get a number that is 4, it will work until first of all, it will check that if the number is greater than equals to 0 or not. If it is greater than equals to 0, it will add the numbers till sorry. It will add the all positive numbers, and then it will print out the number which is the sum at the end. No, my friend Harshit.
Okay, so thank you, Kunal, so much for just introducing the C++ syntaxes and basic programs for the students. And the rest of the part we will be discussing. If you're not clear with the program, I will cover it later. And so you can ask in the Q&A session about what exactly it works. And let me just cover with the segment 2 of the workshop, and which is one of the most interesting one. Let me share my screen. Okay, so basically now I will be just covering the part of the roadmap. Like, everyone was asking like which language they should choose in their first year, and what will the more advantage which language has a more advantage over the other. So we will be covering that part, and also we will be discussing the controller flow, like in C++, the how are the statements are used to control the execution flow in the program. And then we will be getting a brief introduction on the standard template library, which is the STL, which we'll be using in the later part of the workshops. So we will be just covering the basics and not anything in deep. So let me show you the roadmap to the competitive programming, like which I understand according to my knowledge. So at the first chart, it is the most crucial part is to choosing a language. So every student is just concerned like which language they should choose and which language will be the more advantageous at the end of the fourth year. So mainly there are three languages that a student deals with in their first semester. It is the C++, the Java, and the Python. Okay. And the basic thing, like the students are confused in the differences between these languages. So I will just take a brief on the differences. C++ is more of a robust language, and it is one of the fastest language that we have today for programming and development. And if you just see, it is more popular among the other two languages because of its robust nature. It has more features in terms of syntaxes, and it is updated every iteratively every 4 years. So we have a great support in C++ because it's a very old language, you can say, developed at Bell Labs. So all the applications that you see today in the world, like the ATM banks or the other things, they are just developed in C++. And even in, if you just talk about in machine learning, like the TensorFlow APIs, the underneath and the basic, the framework is running on the C++ program. So you just are interfacing with the Python language, but underneath it is the C++, which is running because it's fast. And secondly, Java, if we compare with C++, Java is more of a object-oriented language. They both are object-oriented, but it's more portable in terms of platform independent. So if you want to develop applications, like if you want to develop applications for web or mobile development, then Java is more preferred language. And the people have started doing competitive programming. Java also, it is one of the second preferred language in competitive programming as compared to C++. And when we compare Java and C++, there are similar similarities between those. Like both have classes and inheritance concepts, like they follow strictly OOPs. But C++ has more different framework. It has pointers, and Java somewhere lacks it, but you can also implement that thing with the help of abstract classes. So if you just talk in terms of interview and company prospect, then Java is more of a ready-made and handy language because most of the interviews ask the questions in Java, and because it has more conceptual part, so Java should be at your second step. So if you have to prepare, choose one of the language, you can select Java only if you want to pursue development as well as competitive programming, both sideways. And if you're just moving forward only with competitive programming, then C++ is the best language, I can say. And the third language would be the Python. Okay, so Python, we all know, is a more human interface and readable language with easy syntaxes, and it is made to just make the things perform. So you can apply Python to most of the things. You will see, like in data science, also in machine learning or different domains, Python is a ready-made language. Even in DevOps, like it is a newer field that it is coming. It is getting popular these days. So Python is everywhere, on the server side, on the front-end side, it's running everywhere. But there are some limitations also in Python as compared to C++ and Java. They are supported by big firms, and they are used by senior developers more. So you will get a more robust support on Java and C++ as compared to Python. But Python is also getting popular these days. So you can choose Python if you want to pursue machine learning and data science more precisely. And if you also want to do competitive, you can do it in Python also. So these are the three comparisons. Okay, and now if we just look at the roadmap, like if you want to get a clear visualization exactly what you have to do at each step. So in first year, like if I tell you, in first year you just have to learn a single language, a single computer language, either of the three. And it takes just about like a month, if you can say it. 20 days or 30 days are very much enough if you're practicing and learning it daily. And to be more conceptually aware, you can just learn from the videos or the documents. So basically, apart from that, if you just learning a language basically means that you are familiar with the syntax and you can convert any English, like a plain English problem statement, into the language. And in the middle of that is your logic, like what exactly you interpret from that problem. So these are the three components of solving a competitive question on any of the platform. So the second step in your first year would be to getting the grip in the data structures and logic building. So data structures are basically like how you are dealing with the data in specific language. Okay, if you want to handle, like, you're taking a lot of inputs and giving and processing and then giving the output, so it is very complex to handle such a large amount of data. And you know that most of the applications are based on new and modern data structures, so it is very important for you to have a grip on the data structures. And you should be also familiar with logic building, like how you should apply which logic on a specific data structure. And then the third step in your first year would be practicing different sets of questions on each type of problem. So there are, you know, categories of problem, like just like in you have done in your JEE mains. On each type of problem, there are different sets of problems that you can solve to get a wider grasp on each problem. So when you just see the problem in your interview or your any competition, you can solve it very easily, and you know the trick, like how to just cross-validate the question. So it is very important for you to practice every day. There are different platforms that I can tell you. There is LeetCode and CodeChef. Okay, these are the basic platforms that you can get your hands on. And if you just are getting on a very higher level, you can try CodeForces. It also has a community-rich platform. And the fourth step would start in your second year mostly, when you will be mastering the conceptual part of the competitive programming. So if you're just competition oriented and you are participating in sprints and if you're practicing daily, then you just have to master the newer concepts, because the older ones are now not like they will be repeated so much that you will be very familiar to them. So in the further steps, like in second year, third year, you just have to be careful about the time limit in the time space domain. So basically each program, like if in the competitive programming, we just have to ensure like what exactly the time a program will take and in like what amount of memory it will use. So the person, like the user who do in less time and space gets more edge over the others. So you can try this. Platforms regarding the practicing the questions, the first you can go is the LeetCode. LeetCode has just about over 1200 questions, and if you solve 400 of them, then you can just get a lot of like a mastery on the level. So LeetCode is one of the rich platform that I prefer. And except from that, if you just are just learning, you can use HackerRank. It has daily learning modules, like you can learn also on that platform and solve the questions. So LeetCode, HackerRank is there. Then HackerEarth is also there to practice in different competitions. HackerEarth is rich in competition, so every time you open HackerEarth, you will just engage in one of the ongoing competition live. And the fourth one is the CodeChef. So CodeChef has three different type of challenges: the long term, then cook-off, and the lunchtime. So you just have to Google it yourself and then learn about the platform, because so Geeks for Geeks, if you just want to have a quick glance over any, it's like a reference book to me. Okay, so if you want to just have a quick reference to any of the sorting algorithm or data structure, you can use GFG. And you can also get interview questions and different types of things over there. So it's full of features, and like as much the seniors say, if you are doing the in first or second year, you have to just get rubbed off over GFG to get an edge in the interview section. So you can use this platform also. It's one of the favorite platform for all the users. Okay, so I hope the platforms are clear to you. And just mind one thing, you have to proceed to these platforms only after learning any language. So if you're just clear with C++, just don't go without any preparation. Then you will be confused and demotivated all the time because you are not familiar with the syntax. So I just want to request that you first get your hands on any of the languages, and then you can proceed on the different platforms to practice the questions. So you're familiar with them and you are motivated to solve daily questions. So this is one of the way. And the fifth would be in your third, fourth year. Like if you are just mastered the concepts very much, you can participate in contests, competitions, and direct hiring contests. So you can just get an edge over the others who are not practicing it. And you can just also be hired from the contest also. Like CodeChef is one of the platform which hires. Recently, they have the hiring contest from one of the major company in India. So you can use that in third or fourth year. Okay, so this would be your whole competitive programming in your college life. Okay, the first step is always begins with learning a language. And the next, like now, if you have any questions regarding the about the career platforms, okay, so for the platforms, okay, let me write on this thing only. So you are very much familiar of these are the platforms, three platforms, the basic platforms you can go, and if you want to move forward, you can use these platforms too. So these are the six platforms that you have, that you will use throughout your competitive journey in the college, right? You can just copy and save it in your browser. And if you have any doubts, we will take the doubts in the Q&A session. If you want to ask regarding the advantages of choosing a language and for in terms of career prospect. And now I will be explaining the controller flow in the C++ language. We are more focused on C++ today because it's a main introductory language. And I assume that in your school, like in 11th and 12th grade, many of you must have learned C++ as your elementary language. So that's why we have chosen this language to make you familiarize with the programming. And controller flow basically in C++ means like C++ follows a top to bottom approach. Okay, and basically if you are just executing a program, it compiles the whole program and takes in what you have written first over the other syntaxes. So it is very important for you to understand the controller flow so that you can appropriately apply like which part of the program you have to execute first, and then take the output of that program to another program code block so that you can just make a cycle of the flow. So to execute like the controller flow in the programming language, we have different statements. Okay, and what are those exactly the statements? We will just go through it. Okay, I will just use them in the further workshops, but today we will just have a look at it, like what exactly are the statements. So here is a brief table. We have different categories of flow control statement. The first one is the conditional statement, which is the most and the widely used in any of the programming language. If and switch, if else also, and if switch. These three are the statements that you will deal most of the times. So I can tell you like how they are working, but let's just jump over to another statement first. The jump statement basically tells the CPU to start executing the statement at some other location. So to just doing it very easily, if you have two code blocks in your program, okay, and you want to jump over another section directly without executing one of the programs, so you just use go to. So go to just tells your compiler to switch the executing cursor to that point where you want to start the execution of the program. So you can skip one or two program blocks accordingly while using the GoTo. Okay. Then we have functions. As my acquaintance Kunal has covered this section, function basically are the modules that you create, and you can store any like the logic in one of the function, and you can call it every time you want to execute that particular part in your later program. So you don't have to rewrite everything in your program. Like support, if you want to add numbers, so you just have to take input and you can call the program on it, so it will automatically add numbers for you. Okay, and you can add you can call it multiple times depending on the efficiency of your processor. And loops basically are used to basically repeat the statements over and over again. So if you want one or two logic to repeat itself to perform necessary steps, you can use loops. And there are the three types of main loops that we use: for, while, and do while. Okay, for loop is one of the wider used loop because it is written in one line and sequential order. And in while loop, you have to give the parameters accordingly. So we use while only at different occasions. So halts, we don't have to use it. Like if you want to exit any program, you can use exit this. And exceptions, this is to just throw an error. If you deal with any error or a bug in your program, you can use the exception throwing technique. This is the basic flow diagram of the controller flow. Okay, so I would just show you the syntaxes, but I would just request, I have not included those syntaxes on purpose because I want you to explore first on Google itself. Like I want you to explore yourself, and then if you have any doubts, we will cover take your doubts in the group. And in the next time when you just meet me, I will just ask you some questions regarding it. So better be prepared about this part of the program. And the next is that we have to cover is the standard template library in C++, and it is most crucial because in competitive programming, you don't have to necessarily write everything again and again manually. Okay, there are some standard templates pre-written for you to just use as it is. Like you have to just call, and then it will work for you accordingly. Okay, so I will just show you like what are those some of the libraries you can use. And containers, like we have different template library. One of them is the containers, which has four different parts. The first is the sequence. We just say sequence because the data is allocated according to the sequential memory order. Okay, let me explain. Vector, list, dq, and arrays are four type of sequential data allocating containers in C++, in which you can store data in some order. Okay, so you know what order your data is stored. Okay, this is most widely used in C++. Arrays, I think everyone is familiar of. Arrays is one of the widely used container that we use. So we can use to store data in sequence. And adapter is basically when you want to switch the data at different locations. Okay, you have different nodes, or you want to arrange the data in a different chronological order. So you use adapters in C++. So queue, priority queue, and stack are three adapters that you can use. And then associative is set, multi-set, map, and multi-map. So if you want some data to be associated with other, okay, like you want to store something in pairs, or you want to store a data which is connected to some other data, like they can talk directly. So you have to use these type of containers. And unordered set, basically you use when you have the data in unordered type, like they are not in the correct order. You just randomly have to input the stuff, and then you can arrange, sort, and do multiple operations on them. So this is basically STL. I know that you will not grasp it very easily. This is just one of the call out that we are doing, and don't worry, we will be covering in detail in the later part. Okay, so let me just first tell you अरे एरेस बता दो भैया, आई डोंट नो. ओके एरेस मैं अभी कवर कराता हूँ आपको. ओके सो अभी हम इस पे आते हैं, ठीक है. एडिटर्स, एडिटर आप लोग खोल लो, ठीक है. ऑन दिस वेबसाइट आई एम पेस्टिंग ऑन द मीट. सो जिनके पास अभी लोकल इंस्टॉलेशन नहीं है, ठीक है, वो लोग अभी ये यूज कर लो, क्योंकि अभी इंस्टॉलेशन करने में आपको टाइम लगेगा. बट डू रिमेम्बर, अगर आपको थोड़ा सा फास्टर एग्जीक्यूशन चाहिए तो आप लोकली उसको इंस्टॉल करना ज्यादा बेटर रहता है, बिकॉज यू डोंट वॉन्ट अगेन एंड अगेन टू पिंग योर इंटरनेट एंड देन डू स्टफ. सो आई प्रेफर कि आप जो मैंने आपको नोट भेजा है ऑन द सीएस ग्रुप, यू यूज दैट, यू फॉलो द स्टेप्स एंड अकॉर्डिंगली इंस्टॉल मिनजी डब्ल्यू इन योर सिस्टम. सो एवरी टाइम यू हैव टू एग्जीक्यूटिव प्रोग्राम, आपको जस्ट आपको लोकल एडिटर खोलना है, कोई भी टेक्स्ट एडिटर. And okay, and then you just have to write the code and execute. And regarding the text editors, one of the students was asking me ki why not VS Code and any other thing. So you can use anything. Okay, VS Code is more development oriented, but you can use it to write code also. Sublime Text is lightweight, so that's why I just preferred it for competitive programming. But you can use any of the text editor, right? And these are some of the resources. Okay. I'm pasting these also in your the meeting link, and you can use them at first to start your, you know, journey. The first one is the one of the library which is designed by IIT Bombay. So if you are just starting with this CPP, this you can refer to this document. One of the professor has compiled like designed this library for the first come users. And this is one of the library that is used to teach C++ in IIT Bombay. And then accordingly, you have the Hacker Earth roadmap that I was talking about. And there is one YouTube link. One of the teachers is having a 2 hours workshop there. So you can just refer, you can just study today. Okay. So it is better that you can go through these resources. And now I will be just getting some like, what Kunal has covered, I will be just doing the code part of it. Okay. And we will be doing in a like explaining it properly. So let me just write. I hope everyone has opened their compilers. Everyone just look carefully on this. So this is the empty blank note that everyone will get. Now we will be starting, like everyone is asking why we use this hash. Okay. So we call it as a preprocessor. Okay. It is a preprocessor directive in C++, and why it is called so, because when you will be installing MinGW, just go in that folder and you will be looking like there are many multiple files which is getting the name at the end .cpp extension or .h extension at their end. So those things are basically macros, okay, and we are just including one of those macros to compile our program. Okay, like in Java, you import a package and then your program is executed. Just like that, in C++, we include some of the macros. So the macros consist of different functions or predefined classes that helps your program to execute. Okay, so we use hash to get to know the compiler that we are using any macro in this. Okay, so. Okay, cool. Now let me just start with this hash include. We are including a macro. We use iostream here. Iostream is one of the module which stands for input and output stream. Okay, so if it tells the compiler that we are taking any input and output on the console, that's it. Okay, it has nothing to do much greater than this. Okay, and then most of the students were confused about this, the using namespace std. So why we use it, this is basically a placeholder. Okay, so when we are just using the function of that macro, like cout cin, we have to use like this. If you're not including this, then you have to, every time you have to do the cout and cin, you have to write like this. Okay, the standard. So on older compilers, as one of my friend has told in the meeting, on older compiler it is not required, but the latest compilers they need to be differentiated, like if you're including that or not. So it's very important for you to just write using namespace std once, and it will work on every syntax you are writing in the consecutive part. Okay, stdioh basically is a C library. We are using C++, so now we use just iostream.h. So basically, let me just call out the name. Okay, Divya Jyoti, basically what happens is C++ are different versions also. Okay, so after C++ 14, they have just told us that we don't have to write the .h, we can just skip that part, and we just have to write the name of the library, and some more newer libraries are included. So we don't have to write stdio and then iostream console.h, which you have covered in your school. That's based on a different version and on based on your Turbo C++ compilers. On the newer editions, you can skip that part and you can directly write iostream and using namespace std. So every time you will be writing a new code in C++, you'd have to just include these two things only and nothing else. And and one more thing, like okay, and one more thing, like I can give you, like it is a bonus point. You can skip iostream also. Okay, the library most of the competitive programmers are using, it's this bits stdc++.h. okay, so this is one of the newer additions to the C++. What exactly does it? It includes every like container or macros in one line only. You don't have to include, like for if in the school itself they teach console.h, they have to use for printing the stuff, and algorithms.h and maths.h. Hey, you must be knowing that if you want to use mathematic function, then you have to use this thing. Okay, you have to write every time, you have to write math.h just to use any exponent or mathematical function. But in this, you don't have to write anything. It will include automatically all of those libraries in one line only. So now, from now, you can use bits stdc++.h in every of your language. Okay, you don't have to switch to multiple libraries. And next, wait a second. Wait a second. Okay. Yeah, so next we will be writing an int main. Okay, so why so we are writing an int main is let me tell you. Okay, it's stdc int main. Basically, to tell the compiler that from where our program is starting, we write a main function which comprises of everything of the initial part of the program, except of the functions, except of the classes. The main function is the first initial point from where your program starts. So in this part, you can initialize any of the variables, you can initialize any of the constructor classes and the destructors, like anything in the main. So be sure that you include, do not skip main part, and always just write it at the very bottom. So if you want to declare any function, you can just do it on the top, because it tells the other programmer that you have what functions you have used, and it makes it easy for them to just scroll down at the bottom to reach the main. So we use this kind of order. Okay, so now I will just tell you a program for writing the Fibonacci series up to n number of terms. Okay, that's an interesting part of the question, and in that only I will tell you the syntax of the for loop. So basically, you type int. Int is stand for integer. It tells the compiler that you're using an integer type of data variable, and then you can declare n. N is for the n, like on what mark you want to take the numbers. Then you have t1. We will initialize t1. The first term of the Fibonacci series is always zero, so we are just manually writing zero over it. Okay, then separated by a comma. We will write t2 is equals to 1, because the term 2 is always 1, and for the next term we will just use a 0, and I will just tell you why I use the 0 in this term. Okay, so now we will just tell the user one of the main best practice of writing programs in C++ is every time you are taking input or output, you just have to see out like what type of data you are, what type of input or output you are demanding in the program. So it makes easy for the user to just read and then enter the data, and except that you don't include any cout and they see a very blank space in their output screen. So it's a very good practice that you take care of these things from the very early stage, and also don't use like these spaces unnecessary. So now we will be writing enter the number of terms. We are taking the end from here, okay, and this is for the next line. Okay, then we take the input with the help of cin, right? Then we tell the user that now the Fibonacci series is getting print. Okay, and you can tell it in the next line also. And now the program begins. Now, so what you have to do is we will be using the for loop that everyone is having in doubt in. So what is the basic syntax of for? We just write the keyword for, and then we place a bracket. Okay, in the specific bracket we use an iterator. Okay, so because for loop is iteration based, we use an iterator. It can be any variable, and by practice we default initialize I as the iterator for the for loop. You can use any of variable, and it is better that you use accordingly customized, because in interview they ask why you used I specifically. So you don't have any reason for that. We just use by default. And then this is the initializing part of the for loop. In the second step, we define what are the limits for the specific part. Okay, we have to, this is the basically the termination part, like at when your loop has to terminate. Okay, so we tell that it should, the I, when I is less than or equal to n, the for loop needs to be stopped. It will stop working and it will automatically come out of the control of flow block when it reaches the certain value. So this is the implementation of the control of flow statement. Then you tell the compiler to increment the I every time the for loop is executing, and then you use a curly bracket to write the content of the for loop. Okay, so now we will be writing the logic. Okay, so the Fibonacci tells that if the number, the first term is 1, okay, we use an if statement for this. And if basically tells that if I is matching with the value 1, okay, so one thing that you need to be sure of, I have used a double equal operator here, okay, because I want to compare the values, not assign the values. Be sure of it, because most of the students just write one of equal operator in between and then they say there is error in the program. Because this is an assignment operator, it will initialize the value of I with 1. And if you're using double equal operator, it will compare the values, and then according to the logic, it will execute the program. So you have to write it, okay? And we will be writing the content of the if. Every time you have to write content of any of the syntax, you can use curly bracket to just distinctly identify the things. Now we will be writing that if I is equals to 1, then we just have to print the t1. T1 is 0. So we are just printing the first value, nothing else. Okay, you don't have to be confused in this step. We have just printed out the first term of the Fibonacci series. Okay, and then we say continue. This is one of the other flow of control syntax. This statement basically tells that if you have done with the if part, then you don't have to, every time you don't have to repeat this. When the for loop will again preside over it, this part will be skipped. So we just continue for the next block. So in the next block, we are writing if I equals to, like if the value is compared and it matches, then we will be printing the second term, okay, and we will just print a comma in between for the as a separator, and then we will write continue, same forward, okay, no difference. So I hope you are clear. Okay, one more thing, every time I say a code block, what it means is everything written between these two, like one this bracket and these bracket, it becomes a code block. So I have written two code blocks here in the for loop, one is this and one is this, so you can just distinctly identify the logic. Okay, and when you just continued, now your logic will preside what we say, like the next that we are using, sorry, the next term, it should be the sum of the t1 and t2, okay, because Fibonacci in the third term is the sum of the previous two terms, and the first term will have the value of second term, because we want to swap the values so that the cycle of the Fibonacci can continue. This is the logic. Okay, if you want to just understand any of the logic in the C++ program, you have to do a dry run. And what dry run means, it means like you take a pen and paper and you write the flow of control like for loop, and every time you iterate, you assign the value and then delete it. So you have to do it manually on a pen and paper to understand the logic. So just make it a best practice, like it is very much necessary if you're learning the new things. And then we just have to see out the next, okay, and we print a separator and use this, and then we just exits this and then use return zero, and I will tell you why we use return zero here. Okay, so now the program is complete. Okay, let me minimize it for you to see the code. The program is complete. Now return zero means we have initialized a returning function. Okay, what does that mean? We have used int main here. Okay, int main. Int is used when you want a function to be returning type. It means basically every time you just attain a value or a parameter from one of the function, it returns the value to somewhere, like wherever the function is called, it returns the value somewhere else. Okay, so but we are using only one function here, and that is main, and we don't have any other place to return the value. Okay, so we use return zero, like we don't want to return anything, we want to return a null, a void, and the while we return this, it tells the processor that automatically to jumpstart again to the main. So the execution cursor, when you just execute the program again in the next step, it jumpstart to this point. Okay, after compiling, this compilation is not repeated every time. Okay, if you are using local compilers. So this is the program. Now let's test it with the input. Suppose we want 10. I know there could be some error because this space is getting scribbled. Okay, wait. We have let, so these type of errors could automatically cribble in your program if you are not clear with the usage of brackets. Okay, so this main we have used correctly, it matches the bracket automatically. The for loop is ending here. Okay, and I don't think so that we have mistakenly done anything. Okay, can we skip this part? Okay, let's see if it works. Okay, I was not declared in the scope.
Sir, ek mistake hai.
Yep.
Actually.
Yeah, you can tell.
The 4 is also given in a block, means after the 4 we have to give a bracket, and we don't end it actually.
we like you want let's just like this you are telling.
Yes, sir. Actually, 4 is also coming in a block, mainly 4 block.
Yeah, basically, it is ending here, na? Like we have used 3 out here, and then it will repeat over here.
Yeah,
and then we are using the main.
Initially, we don't use that, sir. Actually, अभी you use this.
हमें for loop के बारे में जो I initialize किया है उसमें value डालनी है कोई?
किसमें
लाइन किसमें I equal to 0 या I equal to 1 वैसे initial कोई value डालनी होती है?
हाँ, you can take the values. मतलब अगर आपको program में needed है, जैसे मेरे को यहाँ पे in time है declare किया, तो मैंने यहाँ पे values as such नहीं डाली क्योंकि मेरे को खुद ही increment करना है automatically. But अगर आपको initialize करना है, तो you can just choose the value. I think you were telling this like this, है ना?
Yeah.
So let's see. If
now it will work.
Oh, cool. Okay, I hope now this is clear. So I have missed one of the initializing part here. So this is the one of the point. अगर आप यहाँ पे initialize नहीं कर रहे हो कोई value, तो वो अपने आप ही garbage value ले लेगा कोई भी, and then आपका program नहीं चलता. So यहाँ तो आप इधर कर सकते हो and i k value initialize, या यहाँ पे कर सकते हो, then it will work. ठीक है. So thanks for this getting this thing noticed. So I hope you are actually सबको clear है, like this part of the for loop. Because इसने flow of control बहुत अच्छे से समझा रखा है. ठीक है. Most of the questions में we use for loop, and if because it's the one line statement control, and if you want कि अगर आपका entry level पे ही कुछ चीज check हो जाए, then you use while statement. Okay. So while statement में आपका हर एक बार logic जरूर execute होता है, and do while में आपका तब तक check होता है जब तक आपका while वाला part to later है वो खत्म ना हो जाए. तो दोनों exit control loops हैं, and this is entry level. So you can use it accordingly. So I think, I hope this is clear. Okay. Thanks Tanish for this. And अगर इसके अलावा कोई किसी को doubts है तो एक बार मुझे just you can call out. Okay. Up you can turn on your mics or either write in the chat section if you are having doubts in this part. Abhi just we are having a Q&A section here. So and one more thing, like जो भी आपकी चीज है लाइक वेरिएबल्स एंड डेटा टाइप्स, यू बेटर प्रैक्टिस इट, बिकॉज़ आपकी जो नेक्स्ट वर्कशॉप है कल, वी आर हैविंग रोबोटिक्स वर्कशॉप. सो इन दैट पार्ट लाइक यू हैव टू यूज दीज थिंग्स, द लूप, द इफ एल्स स्टेटमेंट्स एंड दीज थिंग्स टू कंट्रोल योर रोबोटिक मैकेनिज्म. सो इट इज बेटर दैट आप ये चीज अभी आज ही प्रिपेयर कर लें, जो रिसोर्सेज मैंने आपको दिए हैं यूट्यूब पे, यू कैन जस्ट यूज इट. Kal, your workshop is also there for robotics, and you have to join it. But we have not given the input, or have we? We have given an input, like in this window, we have given the standard input here, and in this output, the like the result is printed. So we do have given the input. Okay, coding block ka software bhi hai. Basically, they have implemented an online IDE. So you can just use it. It is very handy. You don't have to sign up or log in anything if apart you want to save your code. So you can use it for your daily practice. But I will suggest ki aap local installation kar le, because it saves time for the execution. You don't have to need an internet every time you want to execute any program. So local practice ke liye, I just believe that you do install a thing. Okay. Yeah. Fibonacci series mein we have, this is the Fibonacci to an n terms. Okay, there are more version of Fibonacci also, like if you want to print up to certain sum or a multiplication you can use it, but humne yahan pe n terms ke liye kiya hai. So humne ek n value assign ki, we want Fibonacci series up to 10, and then it has used a for loop and then printed it. Okay, so these are the 10 values of the first 10 Fibonacci series. Anything apart doubt, like kisi ko aur doubt hai languages mein, करियर में कौन सा लैंग्वेज चूज करनी है, बट एनीथिंग रिगार्डिंग कंप्यूटर साइंस, बिकॉज दिस इज आवर जीरोथ वर्कशॉप, यू कैन डिस्कस इट लाइक वेरी ओपनली, एंड फ्रॉम नाउ ऑन वी विल बी हैविंग एनी कस्टमाइज्ड वर्कशॉप्स, लाइक इधर वी कैन स्टार्ट विद जावा डेवलपमेंट और वी कैन स्टार्ट विद कंप्यूटर प्रोग्रामिंग बेस्ड ऑन यूर फीडबैक. सो अभी आज के वर्कशॉप में आपको जैसा फीडबैक आएगा, वी विल बी चूजिंग दैट पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक, and Tanish will guide you up, accordingly, like which workshop we will be continuing with. So abhi kisi ko doubts hain to please ek bari bata dein.
Bhaiya, ye Clang STD C++.h support nahi karta. So do I have to download its library? Like
you are using on Mac, like?
Yeah.
Okay, so on MacBooks, like wo default Clang installations ke saath aate hain. And वैसे most of the times तो चल जाते हैं. Okay, I don't know much about like execution, but you have to use any other what we say compiler. So for Mac OS,
I'm using VS Code in Mac right now. But ये हुआ क्या, मैं उसका git पे खोज रहा था कि मुझे मिल जाए. तो मैंने header file create कर दी है इसकी, मतलब जो default storage location होती है वहाँ पर bit/ में मैंने create कर दिया. उसके अंदर कंटेंट जो भरना है वो चाहिए मुझे.
कंटेंट, अच्छा ओके, कंटेंट लाइब्रेरी. बेसिकली आपने खुद से रिसर्च करी है?
हां, मैंने लाइब्रेरी का खुद का फाइल बना दिया एंड मुझे उसके अंदर का डेटा चाहिए जिससे कि मैं उसे लिखकर सेव कर सकूं एंड यूज कर सकूं.
यार डेटा के लिए लाइक डोंट कॉपी विंडोज,
उनका कुछ मिला ही नहीं.
हाँ नहीं, आपको गिट पे नहीं मिलेगा यार. बेटर पता क्या रहता है कि अगर मैक में यूज करो तो यूज होम ब्रू, लाइक उसमें कोई डिफॉल्ट पैकेज कोई आ रहा है MinJW, आई थिंक मैक में सपोर्ट होता नहीं पता नहीं, बट यूज अ डिफॉल्ट. लाइक खुद से मैन्युअली करोगे तो आपको फिर आपको डेवलपर्स फोरम पे जाना पड़ेगा. देयर इज एप्पल डिस्कशन फोरम, सो आप वहां पे जाकर देखोगे वहां पे यूजर्स ने डाली होगी चीज किसी यूजर ने. सो या तो आपको मैन्युअली कॉपी करना पड़ेगा बिकॉज ऐसे कंटेंट नहीं मिलता जनरली, वो पैकेज के साथ बंडल्ड आता है. ठीक है, so I think I recommend you कि आप default installation कर लें पूरा system पे. Clang नहीं चल रहा तो like Xcode, I think Xcode also supports some of the C++ by default, so you can use it accordingly.
मेरा it works fine. ठीक है, वो stdio and ये सब चल जाते हैं, libraries सारी हैं. मेरा बस ये particular वाला नहीं चला, ये stdc++.h नहीं चला, ये अभी video में.
Okay. So I think कि आपके यहाँ तो वर्जन का डिफरेंस होगा या कुछ होगा.
सोर्स कोड चाहिए जस्ट मुझे.
सोर्स कोड प्लेयर यू हैव टू सर्च ऑन गूगल.
ओके,
हाँ अगर मिलेगा तो वी विल डेफिनेटली पोस्ट ऑन द सीएस ग्रुप. सो जस्ट स्टे ट्यून्ड, एक बार पोस्ट कर देना ग्रुप पे टू रिमाइंड इट. सो अगर किसी को मिलता है तो आपको पोस्ट कर देगा एनी अदर मैक यूजर हियर. ओके, और किसी को इसके अलावा डाउट्स हैं कोई? सो यू जस्ट कैन
पॉइंटर्स का एक डाउट था. इंटीजर पॉइंटर, जैसे कि एक इंटीजर का एड्रेस स्टोर करता है और वैसे डेटा टाइप के पॉइंटर्स उनके रिस्पेक्टिव डेटा टाइप स्टोर करते हैं, वॉइड पॉइंटर क्या स्टोर करता है?
वॉइड पॉइंटर बेसिकली मतलब किसी को सिग्निफाई नहीं करता. वॉइड पॉइंटर किसी भी तरह पे मतलब C++ में पॉइंट नहीं करता. वी यूज वॉइड पॉइंटर जिसमें मतलब कोई डेटा टाइप आपको स्टोर नहीं करवाना. जैसे आपको int करे तो आपको int वाले allocation पे point कराना होता है. void में ऐसा नहीं होता. void में जैसे आप void return करते हो, ठीक है, वो general purpose pointer है basically. तो वो मेरे ख्याल से I don't know the use, but void कभी return नहीं करता.
मतलब कोई भी data type store होता है या फिर कोई भी नहीं होता?
कोई भी नहीं होता, वो किसी type का pointer नहीं होता. like मतलब अगर आप उससे किसी int वाले data पे point कराओगे तो वो नहीं करेगा उस पे. it only supports like it returns nothing and it is not associated with any other data type. तो ये चीज है void pointer में.
तो वो यूज किस लिए होता है फिर? ओके, फॉर जनरल purposes.
यप, एनी अदर डाउट्स? If you have any other doubts, you can ask, or we can just wind up the meeting and you can just join the workshop for the robotics tomorrow also at 5 p.m. I think. Kisi ko doubts hai to? Okay. Okay, so Tanish, shall we wind up the session if I stream without the... Okay, so Varun Jain is writing in the chat section to IO stream बता दो और bits HTTC से अलग है यार अलग नहीं है IO stream basically आपका input और output चीज के लिए concerned है like अगर आपके program में आप C in और C out use कर रहे हो तो उसको handle करने के लिए IO stream use करते हैं ठीक है एंड जनरली हम इसलिए यूज करते हैं IO stream क्योंकि हर प्रोग्राम में ये रिक्वायरमेंट होती है बेसिक ठीक है बट HTTC एक तरह से मल्टी क्लास वो है मैक्रो उसमें आप सारी जो भी क्लास वो आपके मैक्रोस मॉड्यूल्स हैं वो एक बारी में ही आ जाती हैं सो इट्स बेटर कि आप बिट्स HTTC एक बार लगाओ लाइक इट्स वन टाइम इन्वेस्टमेंट यू यूज इट वंस एंड यू कैन यूज एनी ऑफ द हेडर फाइल ओके एल्गोरिथम यूज करना है आपको कुछ भी यूज करना है मैथ यूज करना है वो एक बारी में ही इंक्लूड हो जाता है बट IO stream में नहीं होता वो आपका बस इनपुट और आउटपुट हैंडल करेगा सो दिस इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू ओके आई होप दिस इज क्लियर वरुण And I think let's nobody is having more doubts. So let's wind up the session. And assignment as Tanish said, assignment aajega. So you better try it once. Aaj hi aap solve kar le, so that you, if you are just coming in the workshop tomorrow, so you are more familiar with the programming thing. So jisko bhi doubts hain, apne group pe post kar sakte hain is group pe, right? So wind up this meeting. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, sir.